RJ, Rivian finally has an AI story. I actually would like to start by asking why now you're ready to talk a bit more about where Rivian feels its AI competencies are.
Yeah, so Rivian launched the first vehicles in end of 2021, and almost immediately following that, we began the process of designing the clean sheet approach to how we were going to integrate AI across the business. That's on the autonomy platform, and that's at the backbone level of the vehicle, and of course at the enterprise. And in doing that, we redefined the architecture, and the first embodiment of that was actually in our Gen 2 fleet. And so the Gen 2 fleet was a 10x improvement in the compute, dramatic improvement in the camera platform. But while that was something we showed publicly and really launched, think of it as like the data flywheel for building this large training environment for building out our foundation model, we also were developing hardware in parallel that we didn't talk about. And so that's what's going into our Gen 3 architecture. So that's an in-house processor that really significantly improves the compute capabilities in the vehicle, further enhancements on the camera platform as we developed in-house, and then the inclusion of a LiDAR in the vehicle as well.
So those three pieces are the core, but the specifics are important. Wrap one, in-house custom silicon, the LiDAR sensor indented design, cool.
Yeah, it looks really cool.
And then the work on software, that trio is specific to R2 and then R3.
Yeah.
But the point is that it unlocks, to your mind, a not too distant future where those vehicles will offer the owners a genuine set of autonomous capability.
Absolutely. And I think an important point, I'm glad you made the distinction. There's a software element to this that with the Gen 2 vehicles, our R1 vehicles, where this is designed around an AI-centric approach. And so the way that the vehicles are operating, there's a large driving model that we continually improve through the deployed fleet, which is generating millions and millions of miles every day.
Existing R1s, but the second iteration of it, what you call Gen 2.
What we call Gen 2. So those launched a little more than a year ago. And those Gen 2 vehicles are part of the training flywheel for the model, but they'll also see enhancements. And so the first of which we're going to be putting out through an OTA, an over-the-air update, later this month, where we'll expand hands-free from today, just under 150,000 miles in North America, to over 3.5 million miles in North America. And that's where the vehicle will be able to operate with your hands off the wheel. And then shortly thereafter, in 2026, we'll add point-to-point navigation, meaning you can get into the car, plug in the address, and it'll drive entirely on its own to that address.
But require supervision, and there will be attention monitoring.
And so there'll be somebody in the car still, hands off the wheel, but still eyes on the road. And that's actually the demo that we're showing today. And so that's just a preview of what's to come in 2026. What the Gen 3 architecture does with compute levels that are dramatically expanded, so this is, just to put some numbers to this, at the platform level, 1,600 sparse tops.
Right.
We can process 5 billion pixels per second. We include, as you said, a beautifully integrated LiDAR. That raises the ceiling to allow us to take the platform to personal level 4. So the first step before we get to personal level 4 is beyond hands-off, point-to-point. Maintain those hands-off, point-to-point, but take your eyes off the road.
What's your timeline for that, RJ?
That's a great question. So the way we'll launch eyes-off is it won't be eyes-off everywhere. First, it'll be eyes-off on highway. And that'll be coming after point-to-point. So that'll be in the 27 timeframe. And we'll expand eyes off highway to eyes off everywhere. And then the next big step is personal level 4. And what I mean by personal level 4 is the vehicle can operate empty. Mm. It can operate without anyone in the driver's seat. It can pick your kids up from school. It can drop you at the airport. It can go between houses. So it's a complete shift in how we think about the vehicle experience. But that's enabled by this very high level of compute we have in the vehicle, this very large driving model that we're building, and of course the enhanced perception platform.
So there are different academic schools of thought, right? Mm-hmm. There is a future where none of us own our own vehicles. We have purpose-built robo-taxis operated by technology companies through proprietary ride-hailing and fleets, or we do own our own cars and we have expectations that those vehicles have capabilities. Yeah. Which of those camps do you subscribe to?
I think the technology is nearly identical. To do level 4 capability, be able to operate empty without someone in the driver's seat, it's really just a question of which business model you pursue and when. Mm. And for us, the initial focus will be personal level 4, but it doesn't preclude us in any way from participating in rideshare. But it is worth noting the vast majority of miles on the road today are in personally owned vehicles.
Yes.
And so you know, close to 99% of the miles that we collectively drive are in vehicles that we or our household owns. But I think the thing that's so exciting about this AI-centric approach is the model that we have running in our Gen 2 R1 vehicles today will just simply get better. It's accretive with the new sensors and new compute. Think of it like, if you learned to drive and you had bad vision, and suddenly I handed you a set of glasses, your vision would become a lot better.
Right.
Your driving skills would become better. Your ability to learn how to drive a vehicle would improve.
I would see the world with a richer picture.
But you wouldn't lose all the knowledge you had from driving without glasses.
Right.
And so what we do with this next generation set of perception and compute is we not only improve the camera set, but we add these additional modalities. We add a lidar on top of it. We add improved radar. And then we increase the compute of the brain.
You're going to get this question. You're going to have to answer it. You're committing to R2 being, a certain price point. Mm-hmm. You're now adding in lidar.
Mm-hmm.
Your strategy with the refresh on R1 was to have really leading, cutting-edge sensors on the camera side. Those are expensive leading components, right? So how is that going to be possible, RJ?
Yeah.
And we haven't even started discussing the economics of custom silicon yet.
Yeah, there's a lot there. A few questions. So I think first on LiDAR has changed a lot, and I think there are some there's some hysteresis in our thinking around the cost structure of LiDAR. So LiDAR costs have come down, depending on when you draw the line or when you're measuring, from 50 to 100x. So these went from tens of thousands of dollars down to we're talking like low hundreds of dollars at a sensor level, and so it's no longer a big expense. It's a very small percentage of the vehicle bill of materials. And then on the compute side, on the Rivian processor side, this represents a significant cost savings to us. There is a lot of margin, of course, in the semiconductor space. And working directly with TSMC, we have a great relationship with them. And so by removing some of the cost layering or cost stacking that occurs, we're able to deliver an enhanced level of performance much better than what we have on our Gen 2 architecture.
Part of that bet is scale.
At a lower cost.
Right, because the assumptions and models you have is that R2 is going to be a much, and then R3, higher volume product than the R1 generation was.
Yes, of course there's a scale assumption in that. But even just removing some of that margin stacking that occurs, it's a fundamentally lower cost approach. It's an interesting one. Usually you can't lower costs and improve performance, but here we improve performance dramatically and simultaneously lower cost very significantly, but by hundreds of dollars per vehicle in terms of savings.
It is a bold and risky bet. You talked about reinforcement learning, mm-hmm. and GRPO through those reinforcement learning, the ability for an existing piece of software to get better with time.
Yeah.
In those second generation R1s, you use Nvidia Orange chips.
Yep.
Nvidia knows what it's doing.
Yeah.
And you've still made the decision, as I understand it, based on cost, performance, and speed to market, to do in-house custom silicon.
Yeah, that's right. And
a bold bet to go away from Nvidia.
It's also not a bet one takes lightly. Like this is a huge commitment. It's taken us years to both design the chip and now get it ready to launch. Go through many iterations of the chip itself, and then build the whole middleware layer for the development and the development environment around the chip. And of course, we can leverage a lot of the platforms that are out there, things like PyTorch, to speed up the process. But it was a large, large commitment we made to the architecture.
Going back quite a number of years, I remember the conversations we had in earlier days of that first generation R1, even before one came off the production line, really, about how difficult it was to convince suppliers to give you the volume of components you needed.
Yeah.
You were basically saying, we can do this, and they weren't forthcoming with the gear.
Yeah.
With TSMC, it sounds like actually this is a completely different environment and situation.
Yeah, it's... I don't think we could have done that. I don't think we would have been able to get the engagement from TSMC in 2017 or 2018. We had to launch R1, see it be a market success, see people love the brand, and then on the back of that, develop a relationship for our high volume product with, of course, with R2 leading that.
Now there will be skeptics,
yeah.
existing Rivian owners, mm-hmm. investors that will say, you're still struggling a little bit with the basics of yeah. scaling production yeah. of vehicles. You know, I remember the conversations we had where normal Illinois on paper was capable of doing 250,000 vehicles yeah. per annum. You might do 50,000 this yeah. year. Now, of course, the plan is for a completely different product for the mass market.
Yeah. Yeah.
But to those that do say, is now really the right time and is this the right thing to do?
Yeah.
Focus on autonomy and not yeah. just the basics. What would you say to those people, RJ?
Well, I don't think it's a binary. It's a sort of a false binary to have to pick one or the other. So we, of course, need to get the basics right. So we need to launch R2 that dramatically expands the business. One of the things I've said a lot is that Rivian's R&D infrastructure and fixed cost structure isn't designed to be a 50,000 unit company. So we've vertically integrated our entire software platform. We built all of our electronics in-house. As we're now showing, we have a custom silicon platform. We have in-house perception. So these are really big capital-consuming R&D efforts that don't make sense if we're only going to produce 50,000 vehicles a year. Now, they make a lot of sense if we're producing many hundreds of thousands and ultimately millions of vehicles a year, which is how we've designed and architected the business. And you know, it's proven true that by taking this first principles-based approach, vertically integrating in the right areas, it actually does create a better product. And we saw that in our software platform. We did a $5.8 billion software licensing deal with Volkswagen Group. I think the benefits that were enabled by vertically integrating our software and our electronics is it really gave us this foundation to then think about AI coming in on top of it. But what we're now doing in self-driving and the AI backbone in the vehicle, I think takes it even a step further. It's such a necessary big enabler for a huge level of differentiation at the product level and at the technology level.
Paradoxically, is Volkswagen going to benefit from this competence in software? You know, these are Rivian-specific capabilities.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, Volkswagen struggles actually with software historically. Mm-hmm. How have you thought about that?
So everything that we're doing in self-driving and AI is actually separate from our joint venture. So that's purely 100% within Rivian.
Where you license that technology to others is what I'm asking.
It's funny you ask. In the same way that if you'd asked me in 2020 or 2021, do we think that our software architecture and zonal approach to ECUs could be licensed to other OEMs? I would have said yes. But it wouldn't have been clear who would step up to the plate and how that would play out. I think we have an even stronger level of conviction that in the self-driving space that what we're building is so well architected at a platform level, the data flywheel and the benefits of that data flywheel that we're seeing are so strong that it's not hard for us to imagine in the next several years that this becomes a platform we also license.
I'd like to end with the product and the buyer of that product, the consumer. You know. Mm. We're today in one of your Palo Alto facilities. Mm. I came all the way here using Tesla Full Self-Driving.
All right, great.
You know, I do hundreds of miles on it a week and I pay a subscription, mm-hmm. $99 a month, right? Yeah. You are pricing Rivian Autonomy Plus as either a subscription mm-hmm. at $49.99 a month
yeah.
or just upfront, $2,500, yeah. but with the promise that it gets better with time.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, why is that competitive against an FSD?
Yeah.
And why is that price point kind of right for those early adopters and then yeah. the mass market beyond it?
Yeah, I mean, pricing on some of these things is hard to set. Of course, FSD is a much higher price. You know, we do think that in time, these are things that, you know, we think there's maybe the potential to grow pricing, but it's something we don't know. And so we spent a lot of time thinking about what's the initial price to charge for this. If you sign up for $2,500, you lock yourself into that price. It continues to get better.
Is it a lifetime guarantee?
Yeah, so it's something that's with your vehicle. If you buy that, it stays with your vehicle. And if we decide to grow the pricing over time, you know, it's to your advantage to lock it in sooner. But it's such a big area of investment for us. So it's not as if this is the price isn't warranted, meaning we spend more on our self-driving and AI technology than any other category of R&D by far within the business. So it's our central focus in terms of spending. It's our central focus in terms of R&D. And the challenge we've had with that is it's so much energy goes into it, but it, you have to build all this plumbing, you have to validate it, you have to go through the iteration cycles. And you don't see the fruit of that until a lot of work has been done. And so that's where we are today. And that was the reason we decided to have this AI day, is to pull the curtain back on all the things we're doing. You know, as I said jokingly to you as we sat down, it's shocking to me some of these things didn't leak. You know, there's a whole set of buildings behind us that are full of people that have been working on this for years. I'm glad it didn't leak, but now we're able to fully expose it, and fully pull back the curtain on what we're doing.